Perhaps the first female reclining nude in European painting is Giorgione's The Sleeping Venus, painted in 1510. Giorgione's painting started what became one of the great themes in European art, the nude in an idealized setting. She is depicted as a demure goddess sleeping and unaware that a viewer is peeking in on her. The viewer is a spectator, looking in on the Venus's private world, in this case a northern Italian landscape. The painting is considered to be a masterpiece of the Venetian Renaissance and the peak of Giorgione's creative career. In contrast is the Venus of Urbino, painted by Titian, a student of Giorgione's. Instead of showing demure and idealized beauty, his painting is deliberately sensual. Venus is depicted on a couch in a room in a palace. She is not idealized and remote. This Venus is a flesh and blood beauty, awake and aware of the viewer's presence. The painting is divided in half by a green drapery behind Venus's head, calling attention to her beautiful face. In the background, servants are assembling clothing to dress her. Scholars have interpreted this painting as an allegory of marital love. Lying next to her is the pet dog, a symbol of fidelity, used to suggest the bond of marriage. In the window, we see a pot of myrtle, also a symbol of constancy. Perhaps Titian wanted to show that sensual pleasure is an aspect of marital love. Art historians will no doubt continue to discuss and debate the artist's original intent. During the Baroque era, the reclining nude was interpreted by many different artists. In Venus at Her Mirror, Diego Velázquez shows us a back view of Venus admiring herself in a mirror. This is the only surviving example of a female nude by Velázquez. The subject was rare in Spain because it met with the disapproval of the Catholic Church. Venus is shown here with her son Cupid, who holds up a mirror, and we see how she's become absorbed in her own reflection. The painting was probably shown privately, avoiding the disapproval of the Spanish Inquisition. In France, the Rococo artist, who embodies the frivolity and elegant superficiality of French court life at the middle of the 18th century, was François Boucher. He painted flesh with a healthy sensuality, notably in this celebrated reclining nude entitled Blonde Odalisque. What is an odalisque? The word is French and originates from the Turkish odalik, which means chambermaid. In the Ottoman Empire, if an odalisque was of extraordinary beauty or had exceptional talent in singing or dancing, she could be trained as a possible concubine. This nude probably represents a portrait of Louise O'Murphy, a young woman who worked as Boucher's model and was briefly the mistress of Louis XV. The artist does not present her as a Venus of classical beauty, but shows her instead in a provocative pose of erotic persuasion as a sweet child woman. The reclining nude is no longer a goddess of love, she is a woman you make love to. As a painter whose career spanned neoclassicism and romanticism, Ingres' paintings largely depend on drawing and linearity, but he also used color amazingly well. The turquoise of the silk curtain with its decoration of red flowers intensifies the warm flesh tones of his grand odalisque. This nude, painted in 1814, is not intimate. The eroticism emerges slowly from the reserved but questioning glance of the naked woman. This is a tradition that goes back to Giorgione and Titian, but Ingres had painted a living woman and not an allegory of Venus. He sets the scene in a distant world of the Middle East and used discreet hints of the harem, a turban here, a fan there, to locate the nude, who otherwise could really be anyone. By 1863, Manet wanted to translate an old theme into contemporary terms. His Olympia is no nymph or mythological being, she's a modern woman. We can see the strong influence of Ingres and the beautiful precision with which the figure is drawn, the sharpness of contrast between the model and the foreground items, and the rich dark background added a modern energy to the Venetian-type subject, but was regarded with suspicion as an intended parody. Manet's made his nude a common working girl, receiving flowers from a client. The setting is a typical Parisian apartment, and next to her is a cat, a symbol of infidelity. Olympia looks at the spectator as if to say, "Here I am, and what are you going to do about it?" Paul Gauguin, like the Romantic painters, was attracted to exotic locations. Here, a Tahitian woman lies naked on her belly, terrified by the presence of the spirit of death. Behind her, with an averted, phosphorescent eye, the spirit is personified in the form of a harmless old woman dressed in black. Gauguin revisited European subjects and themes, but used the people and the landscapes of the South Pacific, Tahiti, and the Polynesian Islands to populate his canvases. Like Gauguin, Henri Rousseau was fascinated with the idea of the exotic, although unlike Gauguin, he never left France. He imagined exotic locations by visiting zoos and botanical gardens. Amidst all the lush vegetation in this painting, Rousseau has placed his nude on a sofa, reminding us that the exotic locale is but a dream. With the advent of modernism, a reclining nude could be fragmented by cubism, distorted by abstraction, or splashed into drips and patterns. Amadeo Modigliani painted a famous series of nudes between 1915 and 1919. His women are quite provocative. The two dozen or so figures he painted lie on dark bed covers that accentuate the glow of their skin. They are seen close up and usually from above. Their stylized bodies span the entire width of the canvas, and their hands and feet often remain outside the picture's frame. This example is one of the artist's most famous paintings of the series. Does the reclining nude look any different when the painter is a woman? In France, between World War I and II, Suzanne Valandon, herself a former artist model, produced images that owed nothing to the conventional reclining nude. They are absorbed in an activity. This one lies on her back and admires a hat she holds in the air. In the 1930s, Alice Neal decided that she could get to the soul of her subjects by painting them nude. Her body of work includes nudes of men and women of all ages. In 1971, she painted her daughter-in-law Nancy, nude and in the last week of pregnancy. Paintings of pregnant women are rare. Neal's work is remarkable for including at least 8 pregnant nudes. This painting includes Nancy at ease, despite the obvious physical strain of this late pregnancy that resulted in twins. Directly behind Nancy's head, we see Neal's drawing of her son Richard, the husband and father. Large Reclining Nude, a masterpiece of composition and form by Henri Matisse, is evidence of his lasting interest in using the live model to investigate both formal and emotional aspects of figurative art. By the time Matisse finished this painting, his model may not have recognized herself. The finished painting went through 22 separate stages before Matisse was finally satisfied. He documented the evolution of the painting with photographs. During the artistic process, the figure changes from a realistically proportioned figure to an elongated torso with strong legs and arms and a diminutive head. Her blue and white resting place can be identified as a couch from the early versions. The rounded brown, yellow, and flesh-toned shapes of her stomach originally appeared as a vase of flowers perched on the chair behind the sofa. The thick red strip of color resembling a chair rail is actually the floor. Picasso spent a great deal of his working life directly measuring himself against and responding to the great masters of European painting. On one hand, he admired the creations of his predecessors and borrowed ideas, themes, and plots from the past. On the other hand, he always converted them into something quite different. At first, Picasso, like Ingres, appealed to the purity and monumentality of ancient masterpieces, but somehow exaggerated and transformed them. As time passed, the changes became bolder and more radical. Reclining Nude is grotesque at first glance, but a careful look reveals a naked vulnerability. As we try to decipher this image, the marks become more human, and she becomes more and more vulnerable. Beginning in 1961, pop artist Tom Wesselman began a series of paintings he entitled The Great American Nude. He showed woman as the consumer, both consuming and being consumed. But if he presents her as a consumer product, he does so with considerable tenderness. And over the years, Wesselman tended to move even closer to his subject. Early paintings depict her in full. In later canvases, we see specific portions of the anatomy. Explicit though the images are, Wesselman's nudes are not pornographic. They're too remote for that, too glazed, and too impersonal. Romare Bearden's subjects come from his African-American cultural heritage and form the basis for work throughout his career. However, his imagination and concern with classical artistic structure are equally important. The beauty of the black woman was essential to Bearden's art. She is seen here in a minimalist composition that suggests Bearden's admiration for Henri Matisse, whose paper cutouts in the 30s through the 50s would have been inspirational for a piece such as this. And so the reclining nude has become a paradigm for artistic expression across Western culture. Whether she is seen as a remote goddess, an alluring odalisque, or a provocative seductress depends as much on the viewer as the artist.